visit us at facebook.com/securefreedom with Frank Gaffney.
This is Frank Gaffney with the Secure Freedom Minute. America Last has emerged as an organizing principle of the Biden wrecking operation. Examples abound. To pick one, the president has deep-sixed the Keystone XL pipeline and undermined U.S. energy independence. But he cleared the way for the Russian Nord Stream 2 pipeline that will make our allies more reliant on a hostile power for natural gas. Here's another. Illegal immigrants have been allowed into and distributed all over our country without regard for their predictable contribution to upticks in COVID-19 and other public health crises. Yet, Americans are being told they must mask up, lock down, and show their papers. Now, amidst the catastrophe in Afghanistan brought on by the Biden bug out, the Pentagon will not give priority to Americans awaiting extraction, and somehow will find space to bring some 30,000 Afghan refugees to military bases here. Restore America first. This is Frank Gaffney.
Now more with Frank Gaffney.
We're back, and it's a pleasure to say we're joined by a man we've not talked with in an altogether too long time. A good friend of this program and a very valued resource, I hope, for all of you as well. His name is Jeff Nyquist. He goes by J.R. Nyquist. It's the title of his blog, jrnyquist.blog. A terrific source of insight and information that I can't speak highly enough about. Jeff is the author of several books, including The Origins of the Fourth World War, and most recently, The Fool and His Enemy. He is an essayist as well as an author, and just a free-range mind that I'm always delighted to have an opportunity to visit with. And Jeff, thank you so much for making that possible today. Let me start with a topic that, frankly, I know nothing about other than a little bit that I've learned from you, but it has profound implications for the world. And as we're talking, there's a new directive out from government authorities that farmers in the state of Arizona, and I think elsewhere in the West, are going to be deprived of one-fifth of the water allocation that they are accustomed to because of a sustained drought in the western United States. This is attributed notably by the Biden team to climate change. There seems to be something else at work, though, and I'd be very interested in your sharing with us your insights into what that is, and then we'll get into its implications.
Yes. Often people are wondering what is driving global events as we seem to move from crisis to crisis, but I've been interested in something called the grand solar minimum. And it is what the sun does. The sun has a solar cycle that is, of course, 11 years, but there's a longer one. And the sun can do things that can very seriously affect agriculture here on the earth. And I've struck up a correspondence with Valentina Zarkova, who's a Soviet-born UK scientist working in England. She has done this research for many years, showing that the sun is headed into what she calls a grand solar minimum. And the implications of a grand solar minimum, at least now that we're almost 2 years into it, is really very serious fluctuations in weather, floods in some regions, droughts in others, you know, cold air masses moving much further south than normal, warm air masses moving further north than normal. We've seen this over the last year, this kind of weather, the flooding in China, the flooding in Germany, the drought in the western United States. Grain production is seriously been affected globally. We've got freezes in Brazil. The implications are for China as a country of 1.4 billion people is serious. When we have the second growing season in a row, when they only produce enough food to feed half their people. And floods can sweep away granaries. So we don't know what the real state or how desperate the state of China's food supply is. And we can see that when people don't eat, they revolt, as we see in Cuba, with the collapse in Cuba. So they're facing something that's very serious. And when a regime like that faces something like that, they can become outwardly aggressive. You know, we all remember the term Lebensraum from before the Second World War. Hitler was all about this because Germany, of course, did not have enough land to feed its own people. And Central Europe was blockaded during the First World War, and hundreds of thousands starved to death in Germany. I think during the war, probably you could argue that millions died as a result of the starvation. And so now you have a situation that's that same situation on steroids, which China is facing.
So is it fair to say that what is being attributed to global warming by, you know, the various UN panels and other government and non-governmental authorities may actually have more to do with these solar cycle-driven conditions rather than man-induced heating of the planet?
Oh, yes, very definitely. In fact, Zarkova, I didn't even know this. I'd been reading about the grand solar minimum, but I did know. Did you know that the Earth has been moving closer to the sun?
No, I hadn't noticed.
Yeah, but it you would notice because it's so gradual. We're in the Earth started moving closer to the sun in the 17th century, and it's going to continue to be in a closer position for another 500 to 600 years. And this I had no idea, and she explained to me why, you know, there was this heating was due partly to this factor. And also, we have gone through a 30-year period where the sun's electromagnetic field was strong, which blocks muons, which makes less clouds on the Earth, which, of course, a cloudy day is cooler than a sunny day. So the Earth is cooled if the sun's electromagnetic field is weakened. So this is another aspect. And, of course, she refers to, of course, the work of Svensmark, a Danish scientist who has really done tremendous research in muons, or what we know as cosmic rays. They strike the ocean and create greater cloud cover on the Earth. But all that science aside, yes, global warming and cooling, it's not something, you know, we're insects. We don't provide this, you know, and a lot of these much bigger, the sun is huge. We can't, you know, 1,300,000 Earths, you know, or something fit inside the sun. No, I think the number's bigger than that. But it's a huge body with an enormous amount of energy coming out of it. And, you know,
one of my other concerns, and I think you've been following this phenomenon as well, Jeff Nyquist, and that is the sun periodically has these intense geomagnetic disturbances, as they're called. Solar flares, I think, is the layman's term. It's most usually applied to it. But when one of these solar flares is directly beamed at the Earth, it can bathe it in immense amounts of electromagnetic energy. And the last time that happened is 1859. In what's been called a Carrington event. And at that time, we had essentially no telecommunications to speak of other than telegraph systems, which are very robust compared to electronic devices in the face of these kinds of energy loads. And yet, back then, telegraph wires caught fire, telegraph offices burned to the ground, and it was quite a problem at the time, until obviously those situations could be corrected. But it's widely expected, Jeff, that we are overdue for such a boresighted, intense electromagnetic pulse from the sun or geomagnetic disturbance with catastrophic effects on electronic devices and other gear, chips and so on, that have not been hardened to deal with the pulse that might emanate from the sun. What can you tell us about that? Does this have anything to do with the cycle of the sun that you've just been speaking of, or is it just a separate and also very worrying phenomenon?
Well, it does. The good news in this regard is that solar flares occur during tend to occur during solar maximums, not during minimums. What's happening during the grand solar minimum is the sun's electromagnetic activity decreases, and so we have less of a chance of such flares. Yeah, there are multiple electromagnetic fields in the sun, and right now these are basically diminishing, they're weakening. And this is they call this the 25th solar cycle, which began, I think, a year ago in June, because they, you know, a solar cycle is about 11 years on average. They started counting them, you know, in the 18th century. So that's why we're on number 25.
They've been considerably more than 25, I suspect, over the life of the sun.
We've only been counting. And what they are is they basically, they count sunspots. And sunspots are part of the activity of the recharging of the sun's electromagnetic field. So the sunspots are the electromagnetic, part of the electromagnetic effect. And of course, the grand solar minimum is when the sun's electromagnetic field doesn't come all the way back. It doesn't revive. And then there's very few solar flares. So they actually started counting solar flares from telescopes back in the 18th century. And they noticed there was this pattern, this 11-year cycle. And they also later, when we had started to understand electromagnetism, we realized that the sun's electromagnetic field every 11 years reverses itself. That is, it collapses, and then the North Pole becomes the South, and the South electromagnetic pole becomes the North. It reverses and recharges.
Now, that you said the sun's electromagnetic field, but you're talking about the poles on the Earth. Is that right?
I'm talking about, see, electromagnetic fields have their own poles, and on the sun they reverse themselves. The positive and the I don't understand the science, but it reverses itself. But by the way, the same thing is going on the Earth, only more gradually now since the Carrington event. Since the Carrington event, the Earth's electromagnetic field has been weakening, and we know there's a relationship between that field and the sun's. We don't know exactly how it works. But the Earth's electromagnetic field is weakening as well. And it's been that weakening since the last 20 years or 30 years has been accelerating, which nobody knows exactly what that means, except that we're going to have a pole reversal. And what I mean is an electromagnetic pole reversal.
And what does that portend? Again, this science of all this is completely lost on me, but just give us a flavor of what are the effects.
Yeah, there was a German scientist in the 30s who had a very intriguing set of theories. I meant to read him, but what I can tell you is that we don't know, because it is not a common event like the 11-year solar cycle. It has not occurred where we could actually observe it before. It occurs at thousands of year intervals, as I understand it. And there is, in the ancient Egyptian records, if you go back to the record that Plato alleged came from Solon when he visited the ancient Egyptian priest in the 5th century BC, or 6th century rather, that the Egyptian priest actually referred to it. I went and checked, and lo and behold, they had an allusion to an event in which the sun does something to the earth. And it sounds like a massive electromagnetic storm. And their way of describing it is not, it's not clear exactly what they're describing. But the Egyptians, ancient Egyptians, described it as an event that had happened long before the birth of Egypt, that was left to them in some kind of records that people had left behind. And so this is a very curious. We don't really know. You know, this is part of the discourse that led to the discourse on Atlantis, ancient Atlantis, by the Egyptians. And we don't know to what extent Plato embellished it. But some of these statements by these scientists, these ancient Egyptian priests, included saying that the Earth was struck by objects from space that would displace the water in the oceans. So there's there's references to cataclysms in the distant human past. And again, with the Carrington event and the changes in the Earth's electromagnetic field, we just simply don't know what these mean and what it's going to do to us. So in our electromagnetic infrastructures, we rely on computers and power. This is very scary.
I think we know that they will be badly affected if they're not protected. We may not understand the rest of the phenomena and the poles changing and all that. But I think there's a lot of evidence that, and it's one of the reasons why our Secure the Grid coalition of the Center for Security Policy has been working so hard to try to get focused, sustained efforts made to protect our most critical of critical infrastructures, because it's not just, bad weather in Texas or, PG&E power lines causing horrific fires in California. There are these other threats to the viability of the grid, and they must be attended to before, God forbid, something like this happens, or alternatively, some adversary takes advantage of our vulnerability to a EMP, electromagnetic pulse, to take us out. That's a distinct possibility as well. Speaking of the adversaries, let me come back to, sort of your bread and butter, Jeff. You're one of the greatest strategic analysts of our time, as far as I'm concerned. And you've been following closely what the Chinese are doing. You were the person who put me first on to this former defense minister, Chi Haoqian, and you've written about him on your blog, jrnyquist.blog, on a number of occasions, I know, over the years. Principally, I think, in connection with a speech that he made to sort of party cadre back in the early 2000s. Remind us what he said to them and what it signals in terms of their malign intents towards this country.
Well, Chi Haoqian talked about China being overpopulated, and he said, we don't want to use the word Lebensraum because Hitler used that word, and we don't want to alarm people. But he basically said that the land in China was becoming polluted. They were not going to be able to sustain their population, that they had to find land. And any land they went to take, the Americans would defend the people whose land they were taking. So the logical thing to do would be to take America's land, since they had to confront America. And it was a us versus them. He even says at one point in the speech, it's tragic. The Americans have always helped China, but it's them or us. They're going to block us, and we have to go out and have land. And of course, the United States possesses the land. Yeah, meaning the U.S. And then he refers to, well, how do we do this without a nuclear war? And he said, well, we might have to risk a nuclear war. But he said, we can do it with a biological attack. And he talks about a surprise biological attack that, from the way he spoke, indicated that China would not be taking responsibility for it, that it would somehow occur without China being blamed. And it would, he said, he used the term to clean up America and make it so that we could make a second China in America. And of course, he what he meant was, if we can eliminate most of the American population, we can move Chinese there. And we can relieve our population problem.
Yeah. And the advantage of a biological weapon as opposed to a nuclear one is presumably the preponderance of the infrastructure and the other assets of the nation would be intact and available for exploitation by the colonizers. Whereas if you blow everything up with a nuclear arsenal that, by the way, they are rapidly expanding and seemingly intent on having the option of blowing everything up if they choose to. But it would make the colonization option much more problematic, obviously.
Yeah, it is. It is. I mean, obviously, if you look at the biological weapons, are much more efficient. And if you can get away with a biological attack where the source cannot be determined, you could literally wipe out a large population in a short period of time if you have the right strategy.
And as you know, Jeff, the strategy that they have, apparently, and I gather this was one of the things Chi revealed in his speech was the grand design of Deng Xiaoping, the Chinese general secretary of the Communist Party, in the early 1990s when he set this thing in train to win the Cold War against the United States, which he said was now game on after the Soviets lost their Cold War to the United States. He said that this was going to be as a result of a biological agent that had been designed to take out the American population. Have I got that right?
Yeah, he even talked about the possibility of engineering something that would affect, you know, Caucasians specifically. But he was unsure whether they would have the technology in time. And he felt at the time of his speech, he thought that the war was, you know, a decade or more away. He wasn't sure. He was talking about we old comrades. Now, I understand he retired in 2003, and I believe he's still alive. But he said we old comrades may not live to see it, you know, the victory of China. And of course, he'd given another speech earlier about China, you know, the 21st century being the Chinese century, in which China would dominate the world.
Yeah. And Jeff, what do we know? I mean, obviously, we've all been, I think, impacted by a biological warfare agent, which is the way I would characterize COVID-19, coming out of a biological weapons facility with gain-of-function research designed to enhance its transmissibility, if not its lethality. What has that taught us, or what else do we know, basically, about the state of the Chinese biological warfare program and this desire, this stated ambition to tailor weapons for the purposes of eliminating the Caucasian race, or at least our part of it in this country?
Well, it what we've learned, of course, is if you go to the work of Dr. David Martin, what we've learned is that we've got the best enemy money can buy, that it's Anthony Sutton on steroids. If Wall Street built up the Nazis and the communists by doing business with them before the Second World War and during the Cold War, we have certainly built up the biological warfare industry of China. The connections between our CDC and our pharmaceutical companies and China are shocking. They're in Ebony University. They're in the CDC. The Chinese are completely, embedded in our medical system, in our medicines, and all the things we need to treat people, and research laboratories, exactly, in the development of viruses, and this business of giving gain of function to viruses that aren't meant to jump onto human beings and be transmittable from human to human. This is why we're in this terrible situation, because this kind of virus that we're suffering now was, obviously, it's a chimera virus. It was created in a lab. People now are admitting this, where they were denying it a year ago and a year and a half ago.
And when you say a chimera virus, what do you mean by that?
It means it's created. You take a natural virus and you add things. You genetically alter it so that it can gain a function. It can suddenly, a virus, look, people don't realize, just like we have good bacteria in our gut, we have good viruses, you know, like this little virus that mice have that cause cancer in humans. I forget the name. It helps the mouse in its growth when it's a baby. We have things like that in our body. The problem with viruses is when a mouse virus or a virus from a pig or a monkey ends up in a human being or a bat, which is what these coronaviruses are. They're from bats. So it's fine in the bat for the virus to be there. If that virus comes and infects your body, see, it's not normal to you, not part of your system, your biological system. And that then causes illness in us. And what they've done is by taking, possibly terminal, taking a virus from another animal that is perfectly fine in that animal and making it able to jump onto humans, this is really dangerous. technology.
And there's reason to believe that what we've been exposed to in this virus, the Corona 19 virus, is not by any means the worst of what the Chinese research and biological weapons program is beavering away at. Is that right?
Well, imagine the spike protein that causes this blood clotting in basically in COVID-19. Imagine something like that that's even more effective, more dangerous than what we've seen so far, that instead of killing a small percent of people, is able to kill a much larger percent and is able to affect younger people and people in the prime of life. That's really frightening.
And again, can be manipulated and tailored by scientists seeking to maximize the damage done to certain populations. Jeff, this is obviously very sobering stuff, and the fact that we know that this is part and parcel of what the Chinese Communist Party has been up to now for decades makes all the more shocking the idea that U.S. scientists, U.S. Research institutions, U.S. government agencies, for heaven's sakes, would be aiding and abetting it in any way, let alone actually underwriting it or hosting the research being done for this purpose in our laboratories, or relevant to this purpose, if not actually, you know, of a piece with the object. And yet there seems to be very little, if any, corrective action being taken to stop this kind of activity. Or am I missing something?
Well, we go back and remember the Rosenbergs, but in reality, there was a lot of communist penetration of the atomic bomb.
This is Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, of course, who were convicted and ultimately executed for helping the Soviet Union steal secrets of the atomic bomb.
And they were, of course, and they weren't the most guilty people of those that were helping the Soviet Union get that secret. We had scientists that were passing things to them. And there's, you know, things were revealed after the war. Things are still being revealed about what went on back then. You know, how did Stalin get the bomb so quickly after we got the bomb? And now, of course, this the interplay, you know, if we thought it was, you know, so easy for them to get to penetrate our atomic bomb program and get the secret of making that weapon, today the Chinese scientists are here. They're carrying samples of very dangerous microorganisms back from Canada and the U.S. and Europe to their labs in China to develop new strains.
And technologies and technical skills, I think it's fair to say, as well, are being honed here. And Jeff, I guess this is the question that just arises. Is there any effort by the Biden team to wrap this stuff down, lock it up, you know, remove the Chinese? I mean, we've just had five Chinese scientists who were implicated in theft of technology, perhaps akin to this, if not exactly this, who were just essentially got out of jail free. They had the prosecution dropped by the Biden administration. So where do we stand in opposing what the Chinese have in mind for us, apparently?
Well, our defenses are paralyzed by our relationship with China. When you have powerful political and economic interests involved with China, interests that can then interfere with any kind of investigation or political process to look into this, you then are left without any way of correcting a problem that is actually ongoing. This has to stop. I mean, it may be already past help, but it's got to stop. And, you know, someone like Dr. David Martin, who's looked at the patents for some of these gene technologies that were used to build this virus and our own involvement in this with the Chinese, he has tried to get the Justice Department interested in investigating and prosecuting people, because it's a violation. Actually, to make these organisms is a violation of the Biological Warfare Treaty, which is I think it's U.S. Code 18, 175 or 176, in which it says if you, as a scientist, make a lethal organism, that is a crime. And if you collaborate with a foreign government to make one, it's a crime.
I should hope so, and it should be prosecuted as such. Jeff Nyquist, there's so much else that I want to prosecute with you, by the way, on so many other fronts, and I hope we can get you back on very soon. But thank you for this very wide-ranging, very thoughtful, very informative conversation about planetary science and microbiology. It's, you know, the from the universe to the most microscopic of phenomena. It's fascinating how, as I say, wide-ranging are your interests and your intellect, and we appreciate the chance to visit with you whenever we get the opportunity. So do come back to us again soon, if you will. I hope the rest of you will do the same again tomorrow, same time, same station. Until then, this is Frank Gaffney. Thanks for listening.
You've been listening to Secure Freedom Radio with Frank Gaffney.
Night after night, in cities across the country, black garbed assailants clash with police in the streets, smash windows, and throw Molotov cocktails in an effort to destroy police stations, federal courthouses, and local businesses, all in the name of anti-fascism. Most Americans are now, sadly, all too aware of the movement known as Antifa. But where did they come from? What do they want? And how do we stop their campaign of violent mayhem? The Center for Security Policy Press is proud to present Unmasking Antifa, Five Perspectives on a Growing Threat. This new book looks at the history, ideology, organization, finances, and strategy of Antifa, and provides an in-depth analysis for law enforcement officers, policymakers, and the general public. From street fighting tactics of the Black Bloc to fundraising by prominent left-wing foundations, Unmasking Antifa is the go-to guide to understand this elusive and dangerous threat. Get your copy of Unmasking Antifa, Five Perspectives on a Growing Threat at Amazon.com.
This is Frank Gaffney with the Secure Freedom Minute. America Last has emerged as an organizing principle of the Biden wrecking operation. Examples abound. To pick one, the president has deep-sixed the Keystone XL pipeline and undermined U.S. energy independence. But he cleared the way for the Russian Nord Stream 2 pipeline that will make our allies more reliant on a hostile power for natural gas. Here's another. Illegal immigrants have been allowed into and distributed all over our country without regard for their predictable contribution to upticks in COVID-19 and other public health crises. Yet, Americans are being told they must mask up, lock down, and show their papers. Now, amidst the catastrophe in Afghanistan brought on by the Biden bug out, the Pentagon will not give priority to Americans awaiting extraction, and somehow will find space to bring some 30,000 Afghan refugees to military bases here. Restore America first. This is Frank Gaffney.